modified and is included in the MOS. The type of catalyst which have been discovered and patented by Dow Chemical Company in Carbide Corporation. Of course, there's Fischer-Tropsch synthesis, homogeneous methods, and I would kind of group isosynthesis under these depending on the type of catalyst. The MOS2 catalyst is a good hydrogenation catalyst, and under the experimental conditions given, do form hydrocarbons. When we dope those catalysts with alkalis such as potassium and cesium, the selectivity is altered from hydrocarbons to alcohols. Last week in Dearborn, I showed that the surface coverage as well as the bulk content of the alkali, the two catalysts shown there, are the same. Therefore, you can see that the cesium catalyst is the more active catalyst. Therefore, we face most of our further work on the cesium-containing catalysts. Now, the cesium content of these catalysts affects the alcohol activity as well as the selectivity. As we increase the doping, the hydrocarbon yield decreases. At the same time, the alcohol synthesis activity increases and goes to a maximum. The maximum is somewhat temperature dependent, but it is generally between 10 and 20 weight percent of cesium on the catalyst. Under experimental conditions here, higher alcohol synthesis conditions, 295 degrees, about 82 atmospheres, a hydrogen to Cl ratio of about 1, and that's what we typically use for the alkali OS2. Catalysts. Now this is just two micrographs of two different tested 10 weight percent catalysts showing you that the cesium compound sits on the surface of these catalysts as rather uniform hemispherical particles. And the bulk of the catalyst is the MOS2 piece. So it's not a highly ordered, not a highly crystalline MOS2, nor is the cesium compound crystalline, and you don't pick up any diffraction peaks from it. Above 20 weight percent in these catalysts. Now, what I'd like to tell you about today principally is our isotope tracing experiments of the fate of CO in these experiments, and that is what happens to the carbon, what happens to the oxygen, and I'll give you some predictions of what we think is the role of oxygen and how it influences the activity and selectivity of these catalysts. We will be using carbon-13 labeling. We will not show you any oxygen-18 experiments, so we'll show you what we predict, and perhaps those predictions can be checked in the future. Condensable products are analyzed by carbon-13 NMR. The gas products are collected, analyzed by GC mass spec. This is an example of the NMR experiment works. What we've done is taken the linear alcohols indicated, methanol and butanol, and we see that every carbon in those alcohols is distinguished from every other carbon. For example, methanol, if we take ethanol, we see two carbon resonances for the ethanol, and so on for all of the products. What can be noted is that the ternary, or terminal, rather the terminal carbons are low ppm. The carbons adjacent to the oxygen in the alcohols are at high ppm shifts relative to TMS. So this is a way we can qualitatively as well as quantitatively or semi-quantitatively determine the carbon that's labeled in the products that we will be analyzing. Now what we've done is injected labeled methanol into the synthesis gas under reaction conditions and then trapped the products, looked at the products, and determined which carbons are labeled. So we're injecting the methanol labeled with a carbon-13, 22 enrichment factor or so. We see with ethanol that's being formed that the carbon, the C2 carbon, is the one that's enriched. This is native abundance of carbon and ethanol. We look at propanol, we see the same effect. The terminal carbon is the one that's enriched. You get almost natural abundance of carbon in the other two carbon positions. So we would say from these results that what we see is the CO insertion occurring, and then we're covered. You might not be able to see them, but the numbers indicate that the enrichment follows a trend. The enrichment here is decreasing because we're making methanol, which is diluting the label in our product. The terminal carbons are also being enriched similarly as the methanol is in the product. We also see the esters being formed, and they're methyl esters. And in the case of methyl formate, we see the enrichment is high, remaining about the same as the product of methanol being put into the reactor. This really is because we're getting about an equilibrium yield of methyl formate, which is not true for the other methyl formate, methyl esters. So we can follow the enrichment of all the carbons in the liquid product. We collect the gas product, analyze that, and what we show here is the enrichment for the methane. We look at the enrichment that is rather similar for methane and for methanol. See that within experimental error, they're pretty close. This indicates that methane and methanol are being formed through an intermediate that's interconnected between these two products. I'm going to say more than they're just interconnected. But we follow this, the gas hourly flow rate dependence. We will see that methane shows all the indication of being a secondary product being formed from methanol. So we would say that the hydrocarbons are formed as secondary products from the alcohols. Industrialists don't like this because they would like to minimize the hydrocarbons, maximize the alcohols, and our experiments indicate that the two are interconnected and we're always going to see some hydrocarbons. So this is the scheme of chain growth that we would propose is important in this catalytic system. We note that there's a methyl group, alkyl groups in this mechanistic scheme. Once we have this, growth can occur by CO insertion, which is a classical chain growth mechanism, or we can get hydrocarbons formed. And these are interrelated through a common intermediate. The fast step is the first one, first carbon-carbon forming step. Therefore, we can maximize the product yield with ethanol. And in fact, we can change the experimental conditions so that we can form methanol and ethanol with approximately equal yields. That's certainly not the Anderson-Schultz Fourier distribution. And it's easy to do if we put cobalt in the system, which acts as a methyl transfer agent also. So here we can change the selectivity and the yields by experimental conditions. The next slide, I will show you that we have carried out a chain growth scheme in which we put in the kinetic parameters for the growth of all the products that we observe. So we have our alcohols, we have esters, we have hydrocarbons, we have the chain growth scheme and how these occur. These constants represent kinetic constants that we can model. These are hydrogenations for the esters and the alcohols. Alcohols are formed reversibly in the model. The hydrocarbons, the esters, are formed in lower yields. And we say that they're formed irreversibly and leave the catalytic surface. So we've done the development of a kinetic model. We can estimate these kinetic parameters. Once we have those, we can estimate product selectivities and yields under other experimental conditions. As an indication of the model, here at Bosch, you can see this. But what we put in is the experimental data, that is conversion and selectivities, as well as the initial parameter estimates. So you need to guess what the experimental parameters are, which reactions are fast, which ones are slow. We can then carry out the modeling, either for an integral reactor or differential reactor, whatever conditions you're interested in, and it will compare the calculated responses with the experimental, and what you get out are good estimates of the kinetic parameters. Once we have those kinetic parameters, then we might want to make predictions. We can put in the experimental parameters, kinetic parameters, and the reaction conditions,
either for a differential reactor or an integral reactor, and what we get out are the yield selectivities of perhaps conditions that haven't been tested, but that you want to predict. For example, you might want to say, what will happen if you change gas hourly space velocity or hydrogen to CO ratio? I'll show you that in a minute, but what we've used it for here in this example is we've taken the Dow patterns data from the European patent application, where they just give C2 plus products grouped together. Well, we put in the information for the upwells in our model, make guesses for the kinetic constants, and we get the breakdown for the hydrocarbons that you would expect. And we have done this for all of our catalyst tests, other Dow tests, as well as human carbide. So the model works in comparing the data. Now, just as an example, we want to take one set of experimental selectivities to predict what we will observe under other conditions. For example, this is changing the hydrogen to CO ratio. We can do that, put in the parameters in the model, and what this would indicate is that as we increase the hydrogen to CO ratio, the selectivity towards alcohol should be increased. So this would be one way, perhaps, to increase the selectivity towards alcohols. Other things that we've tested would be to increase the pressure while decreasing the temperature. Those two factors also would indicate that we should get a higher selectivity towards alcohols. Now I'd like to briefly describe our testing of copper zinc oxide catalysts and compare the proposed mechanism of that alcohol synthesis with the cesium copper zinc oxide system. Now you might note that again, we see cesium being a more active promoter than the other alkali. And in fact, it increases the activity of base copper zinc oxide catalyst by approximately a factor of 2. Where the doping and the alkali metals are all about 0.4 atomic percent, which is about 0.4 weight percent, cesium formate or cesium hydroxide on these catalysts. As the surface doping has carried out with the cesium MOS2 catalyst, you'll note this is a low doping level, whereas before with the MOS2, we were using 10 to 20 weight percent of the alkali dopant at an optimum concentration. So again, we've used the cesium promoted catalyst. This is our best catalyst. And again, we see that we see a maximum in the cesium doping level on the activity. This indicates that this catalyst, again, is a bifunctional catalyst. We put on cesium, we would say that it activates CO. If we put on too much cesium, it's covering up the hydrogenation function of the catalyst. So again, we're using typically about 0.4 weight percent doping level because the ester generation is lower. As we increase the doping, say even to 0.8, which is good, we get more ester formation, however. So we tend to stay at 0.4 weight percent. This is to show you that we can generate a large range of products over this catalyst, and we can analyze for them. We do see traces of hydrocarbons. They're minimal compared to the MOS2 catalyst. We do see linear primary and secondary alcohols, as you would expect. However, with alkali doping, we see rather large yields of branched primary and secondary alcohols. We also see aldehydes, ketones, and the methyl esters under these conditions. These conditions are 310 degrees C with a low hydrogen to CO ratio of 0.5. So we're using a hydrogen deficient synthesis gas to drive the synthesis to the higher alcohols. This is simply to show you that we do have a wide range of products. And in the next slide, I've grouped these together, again, at 310 degrees, but at a much lower gas hourly space velocity, to show you that we can drive a reaction to form 2-methyl-1-propanol, the isobutanol. So on molar carbon basis, we have an energy octane-rich fuel methanol, isobutanol. And we see that we do form other products, but they're minimized. Other alcohols we get are ethanol, propanol. You might note that ethanol here is at a minimum. And this contrasts with the cesium MOS2 catalyst, where ethanol could be driven to be a major product. You might also remember that over the cesium MOS2 catalyst, the products were linear alcohols. And here we're driving it towards branched alcohols. Again, we've done the probe experiment using carbon-13 to investigate how the carbon chain growth proceeds. In this case, we're using enriched ethanol enriched in the C1 carbon. We're using the higher alcohol synthesis conditions. What we observe is that as the synthesis occurs with synthesis gas, right, a C1 oxygenated intermediate synthesis gas, our product is labeled C1 position of ethanol. Well, I should not say that. That's what we're putting in. But we have native abundance ethanol also. But as we add a C1 intermediate to ethanol, what we observe is the product is propanol labeled on the terminal carbon. This is not what you would expect from CO insertion. In fact, we had CO insertion going, this is the product that we would expect be the predominant propanol in our product mixture. When we look at the branched isobutanol, we see that the enriched position is again the terminal carbon. So again, this is not what you would expect from CO insertion. We're getting branching by some other mechanism. To show you that this can be carried out and verified by injecting other alcohols. And in fact, we can even do it in the absence of synthesis gas if you wish. We didn't do that here. We have synthesis gas and we have a reaction going on. We're injecting carbon-13 labeled methanol and ethanol. What we observe is that these two couple together. The label this time, however, ends up predominantly on the carbon adjacent to the alcoholic group. So I think from these two slides, you can see that when we couple alcohol of alcoholic species, in this case, the C1 oxygenate is retaining the oxygen. The longer chain oxygenate is losing its oxygen. So what we get is the C1 that's going on retaining the oxygen. The other species are losing the oxygen from the longer C2 fragment. I'll show you that what's happening here is coupling of oxygenated intermediates and not CO insertion. So in this case, in the case that I just showed you in the last slide, we have ethanol. But in enriched methanol, what we see is propanol enriched in the C1 carbon. We carry the synthesis on. What we see is isobutanol being formed, where the new label retains its oxygen. We get isobutanol, where the newly labeled oxygenated C1 holds onto its oxygen to form a new alcoholic species. This oxygen is lost. And this comes about because of the cesium doping on the surface. We don't get much of the branched alcohol if the cesium is not on the surface. So what we think is happening is that the cesium acts as a pinning agent in which a selective pinning agent in which this oxygenate part of the molecule, the reactive intermediate, can be hydrogenated while this oxygen is going on. An aldol type synthesis is not hydrogenated until the very last step of the reaction when the alcohol desorbs. So we would call this aldol coupling. We have beta addition of a C1 oxygenated intermediate, but with oxygen retention reversal. That means it's the opposite of what you expect from classical organic aldol synthesis. And it's an effect, a specific effect of cesium on the surface of the catalyst. So again, we developed the growth scheme for the alcohols being formed. And both linear and branching alcohols, and the esters. Again, they're methyl esters that we observe in the product. Kinetic parameters are, unfortunately, we call it L for linear growth. It's not a linear growth, although that's what we thought was occurring originally. We thought it was a methyl addition, which led to growth. It's not, it's coupling of oxygenated intermediates. This parameter, again, is about an equilibrium parameter for equilibrium yield of methyl formate. These parameters we're presuming are equal under synthesis conditions to form the methyl esters. And these branching parameters, the beta addition, are equal once we get above the C2. Again, the C2 can go to a C3 either through a coupling to give us a linear product or by really a beta addition to again give us a linear product. So we cannot distinguish in this case. This is to show you that we can model the synthesis using the kinetic modeling program we've developed, and we can match the measured observed product yields with what we calculate. And again, we can get predicted yields if we change conditions. Where do we need to go to increase the yield of the isobutanol? Where do we want to go to increase the concentration of the branch C5 product, for example, in our product mixture? So again, the program works, and since it works, it indicates that we might have a good basis for our rationale of the mechanisms in these two systems, and that the hydrogenation of the intermediates are different. In one case, it's oxygenated intermediates. In one case, it's insertion, which then undergoes hydrogenation. So that's really what I've summarized on this slide. We have CO insertion over the MOS2 catalyst. We have aldol coupling in the copper zinc oxide case. One minimizes ethanol, the other maximizes ethanol, and an alkyl methyl intermediate is a very important species to be considered in these catalysts. Thank you.
Thank you very much.